Okay, let's talk today about the cachea needle problem. Let's say that we're in the plane and we have an arena in the plane. Someone hands us a pole of size 1 meter. That's the needle, we'll make it a pole. Our job is to move the pole around in the plane, not necessarily just simply turning it, but maybe sliding it and turning it and doing tricky things, but always keeping it inside the arena so that at the end of whatever we do, the pole has turned by a full 360 degrees. And the question is, how small can we make the arena?
The first thing I thought was that the minimum size would be a circle with a diameter of 1.
Yes.
I'm wrong.
You're wrong. Cachea had a guess, and that works, and that beats a circle. Well, I would like to show you how you can make a very strangely shaped arena with an area of, let's say, less than 1/1 billionth of a square meter, inside which the 1 meter pole can be turned through a full 360 degrees. That's the cachea problem. Imagine that I'm given an arena, and I'm given a pole, and the pole has a face at one tip. No matter which direction you pick out, I can somehow place the 1 meter pole inside the arena so that the face is facing in the direction that you provided for me. Okay, now we'll see that that is not the same thing as the full cachea problem, because maybe as the direction varies smoothly, maybe the pole would have to jump around. Okay, so we will not worry about that at first, and our arena will have the defect that the pole will in fact have to jump around. In this version of the problem, the pole is just supposed to be a line segment with zero thickness. So in the first version, let's take a very thin slice of pie. So here is a circle, and here's a slice of pie, a sector. Let's say that this angle is theta. Let's say this radius is 5. The area of the sector is proportional to theta. So the exact constant doesn't matter. Let me pretend that the area is, let's say, 1,000 times theta. I didn't tell you in which units I measured theta. Is it degrees or radians or whatever? The exact value of this constant doesn't matter at all. I'm going to say it's 1,000. The other thing I'm going to do is to scale the problem up. Let's say the pole is 1 meter. And then I think of this as a map of the real thing, and there's a scale, and the scale is 1 billion to 1. Or let's say n to 1, where n is enormous. On the map, I can turn a pole of 1 meter size. In the real world, I could turn a pole of n meters size. Whatever the area is of the region on the map, the area in the real world will be n squared times as big, because it's n times bigger this way and n times bigger that way. So if I don't do anything very clever, if I take a circle or if I take Professor Kakea's idea, if I think of that as a map and I scale it up by a factor of n for some very large n, what I should expect to see is to be able to turn an enormous pole of size n inside a region of area n squared. But what I'm going to show you is a way to turn a pole of length n inside a region of area n rather than n squared. That's much smaller. It's smaller by a factor of n. And so whatever I have done in the enormous real world, I will scale it back to the scale of the map, and then I will be turning a pole of size 1 inside plane figure, a very weird one, of area 1 over n. And since n is as big as I please, the area of that weird arena will be as small as I please. So I'm turning an n-long pole inside something whose area is going to be proportional to n, and if I can do that, I will win. This is all based on a simple construction. Let's say this is a triangle. Let's say it has a horizontal base, so I'll draw a horizontal line here. Let's bisect the angle, and now let's take a slightly higher line, like the horizontal line like that. Extend that line and that line, and then from here and here I will move parallel to this angle bisector. There are a lot of triangles in this picture. Let's look at them. First there's, let's say, this one connecting the black dots. Then there is this one connecting the red dots. If you slide those triangles, what you get is a slightly bigger copy of the triangle you started with. It's similar but slightly taller, Let's say this is k meters. K is very big. This is, let's say, 1 meter. Inside the original triangle, I could slide certainly a pole of length k. In the two new triangles, I can slide a pole of length k plus 1. But if I try to do that, there will come a moment at which I have to use magic or something. So I can move through the same range of angles as before, but I'm only adding a little bit of area. I'm only adding 2 ears. This length here is 1, so I don't want to work out the full derivation, but I think it's plausible that that these lengths here are no bigger than 5. The total area of the 2 ears, according to our formula for the here for the area of a sector, these 2 ears have area something like 1,000 times the total angle of the ears. And what is that total angle? Well, that's 1/2 of the angle of this guy, because we bisected the angle, and so it's like 500 times the angle at the tip of the original triangle. Now let's repeat the construction. Let's say this is 45 degrees. This is maybe, I don't know, 1 or 2 or 3, it doesn't matter. Let's say this height is 1. Let's mark off a bunch of horizontal lines all the way up to n. Now look at this triangle and do what we were talking about before to it. Let it grow a pair of ears. Now we've got 2 triangles. Draw a pair of ears on each of those. Now we've got 4 triangles. Draw a pair of ears on each of those, etc. Keep on going n times. And at the very end, you have 2 to the nth power triangles, each with angle 45 degrees divided by 2 to the n at the tip. Because each time I grow a pair of ears, I double the number of triangles, but I have the angle at each triangle.
Okay? Okay, that's a monster you've made there.
That's a monster. Notice that inside the arena, I can turn a pole of length n, but there is a problem. I have to do this magic jumping. Never mind, we'll fix the magic jumping later. So we can turn a pole of length n. Fine. Now what's the area of the arena? Let's start with our original triangle. It has whatever area it has. 11, I don't care. It grows a pair of ears. We decided that the area of the pair of ears was something like 1,000 times the angle at the tip. Now notice that at the nth stage, there are 2 to the n triangles, each one with an angle 45 degrees over 2 to the n. At the very last stage, each ear has an area of, let's say, 1,000 times this number, but there are 2 to the n of them. So altogether, the total area of all the ears that we've added at stage n is 1,000 times 45 degrees, okay? Because the 2 to the n's cancel when you multiply. Well, that was also true at the n minus first stage and at the n minus second stage. At every stage, there are some tiny angles and a huge number of them, and they add up to 45 degrees, and therefore, at each stage of this construction, you added a total of, let's say, area 1,000. There were n stages of the construction, and so the total area of all the ears at all the stages of the construction is like 1,000 times n, plus the 11 that we started with, which is irrelevant. Okay? So that's, now remember, our goal is to beat n squared, and we've done it. We've got 1,000 times n. We take this weird picture, and we scale it down, making a tiny map with a scale of 1 meter on the map equals n meters here. And we have produced a geometrical figure whose area is something like 1,000 divided by n, in which we can turn a pole of length 1. After you scale it down, this very weird arena would fit comfortably inside a square of radius, let's say, 3, of side length 3, or a circle of radius 3 or 4. So, so far, we're not going into deep space. We went very far away, but we were turning a very big pole. And after we scaled it down, it's not so big anymore. It just has tiny area. All right. So now we're going to solve the jump problem. So again, the magic jumping is that from time to time, we will find ourselves here, and we would like to be facing the same direction, but in a different place. And so we will just jump. And that's what I'm calling magic jumping. So we have to do that a finite number of times. All right, so we have, never mind what the arena is, but the arena includes a pole of length 1, and we would like to move it to another location, so it has moved, but its direction has not changed. It is parallel. Going to change the direction slightly. Let's call both of these angles theta. We're going to make theta very small, and we'll see how small in a minute. We have had to turn the needle through that little slice of pie and through that little slice of pie. And we decided that the area of one of these things, if this is of length one, the area of each of these guys is maybe something like 1,000 times theta. And there are two of them, so there's 2,000 times theta. Our two guys are facing very, very slightly different directions, and we slide these needles until they meet. So here, let's say, is something of length one, and here is something of length one. And if we turn this guy by theta, and we turn this guy by theta, then this angle is maybe 2 theta or something like that. Now, how much area did it take to slide? Well, zero, because these are just line segments. Maybe it feels weird to have a line segment as part of our arena. We say its thickness is T, and this distance is whatever it is, this distance is D. Then we have simply two rectangles of thickness T and distance D. Now, before I decided to thicken this guy, I could calculate what D was in terms of theta. And so once I have done that, I take T to be so small that D times T is, let's say, smaller than theta. So I know what D is, and it's going to be very big because the two poles are almost parallel, and they're going to have to go a very, very long way before they meet. So this D is a very big number, and this angle theta is a very small number. So this is big, and this is small, and so this T is going to have to be real, real, real small for this to happen. Never mind, we just pick T that small. So now, what is our region? We have, let's say, we have this slice of pie. We have this slice of pie from the previous constructions. We have our very long but extremely thin rectangle here and here. And finally, we have a slice of pie of length one that enables this needle to turn until it's facing this way. You have to build a bunch of them every time you want to make one of these magic jumps.
I'm with you.
Okay, and that's it. Well, now we want to travel through the full 360 degrees, and so again, we simply rotated and put them together, and that's it.
How would you describe this shape? It's like just a series of tiny ears.
Yes, so it's tiny ears growing out of tiny ears growing out of tiny ears, and as you grow away from the base, the ears get tinier and thinner. The problem has an interesting history. Kakeya posed the problem in 1917, at the same time, the Russian mathematician Besikovich discovered the set with ears and saw that there was a segment pointing in every direction, or in every direction within one quadrant. He was in Russia in 1917, so various other events were taking place, and his discovery did not become known to the outside world for a long time. And the connection with Kakeya's problem was slow to be realized. The mechanism to get rid of the magic jumps was discovered by a Hungarian mathematician named Pál.
I imagine if we were doing this in the real world, this would be a time-consuming process.
Yes. Somebody once wrote about this problem, that a person trying to turn a long pole in a dense forest could appreciate this problem.
For 2,000 years, people played with the ruler and compass and worried about that. And then something amazing happened. It got connected with the rest of mathematics. That often happens in mathematics. When a problem gets connected to something else, it becomes accessible. Actually, this felt a prodigy. A pimply 19-year-old, Carl Friedrich Gauss, in 1796,